Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr. Tonight's guest, noted author Paul Goodman. Our topic, are public schools necessary, Mr. Buckley?
Mr. Paul Goodman is, roughly speaking, everything, except, as far as I know, a basketball player. Everything else he excels in. Mostly he is known for his original essays on subjects usually written about by sociologists. There is a sense in which, among other things, Mr. Goodman is a sociologist, however disqualified by his ability to write English. But he is not merely a sociological chronicler, but an original thinker whose insights, for instance, in his book Growing Up Absurd, tend to rock readers who approach them from whatever direction, because they are startling and, many of them, instantly plausible. I suppose I should list Mr. Goodman's eccentricities. He is a pacifist, a bisexualist, a poverty cultist, an anarchist, and a few other distracting things. Where he stands ideologically in conventional terms, it is hard to say. Probably no one would wish either to claim him altogether or to disclaim him altogether. One commentator has written that more, quote, conservative insights have germinated in Paul Goodman's mind than in the minds of the entire body of the American conservative community. Mr. Goodman is a stern and interesting critic of American educational axioms, and we are here to discuss whether public schools are necessary. If any of you believes that this is a shocking subject even to bring up, steel yourself for something worse. Mr. Goodman doesn't believe that literacy is even necessary. I'd like to ask why, Ms. Goodman.
I'd like to comment on one of points of your introduction, though it might, and it might lead into the other subject. The word poverty cultist is rather funny. I'm not a poverty cultist. I do think that it's a sign of a good society that it is possible to live in decent poverty, especially if you so choose. That is, if you have more important things to do than to make money.
Well, that's a little bit different from what you wrote, because you said, quote unquote, a decent poverty is really an ideal for serious people.
Well, that was just a quotation from the rabbis who say that that poverty makes a saint if you can take it. And Peggy says the same thing. Mm-hmm. He distinguishes, you remember, between misère and pauvreté.
The trouble is we have
misère and we don't have pauvreté.
Well, a lot of people take vows to poverty, but it's not wrong to call them poverty cultists.
Is yes.
In
well,
any
I'm
case, I didn't mean to offend you.
Yes. Well, no, I was just I'm struck by it. Now, if we mean by literacy knowing the art of reading and writing, where the objects of the art are imagination and truth, then, of course, to be literate is, importantly to be fulfilling yourself as a human being. But if we mean by literacy being processed so that you can understand the code in order to buy products or obey orders or the rest, then it's a question whether most people wouldn't be freer if they weren't quite so caught in this code.
We have at least two definitions of literacy. I'm sure there may be even some more before the evening is over. We'll be back to Firing Line in just a moment.
Well, Mr. Goodman, even if it's correct that some people don't use literacy in order to stimulate the moral imagination or
majority,
to pursue truth.
Majority.
Or art, even if that is so, is it necessarily so that the development of that particular skill isn't in and of itself worthwhile on the assumption that it might be used for a desirable end?
Yes, surely so. I agree with that. The issue rose in a book of mine, Compulsory Miseducation, which I guess you're referring to here. In terms of the to-do which is made about teaching reading and writing in the schools, and also the alarm at the fact that there is so much failure in teaching reading and writing. Now, my own feeling, and I think that this would be the opinion of psychologists, is that under urban or suburban conditions, normal kids, those who aren't emotionally blocked or culturally impoverished or so forth, would learn to read and write anyway, because they're so exposed to the code, by age 9 or 10, if no effort whatever were made to teach them to read and write, just as they learn to speak with no effort being made to teach them to speak except to talk to them, namely to expose them to the code. On the other hand, if you try to teach them to read, you would have the same effect as if you try to teach them to speak, namely about 30% would stammer and stutter. There's no question of that.
You mean to say that systematic efforts to teach people how to read are in and of themselves not worthwhile, because
if we mean by teaching to read now, not the art of reading, mm-hmm. but to pick up this code, mm-hmm. I have a feeling that plain exposure for the average normal kid would accomplish it better.
But isn't it true that...
This would have to be proved by a considerable experimentation and yeah. so forth, but I'm afraid that the the evidence is in my direction, and that most of the to-do which we have in the public schools on this issue is just the to-do of entrenched professionals.
Well, do you simply disavow the data of people who have made and superintended massive national efforts to eliminate illiteracy? And do you say that it's all chicanery?
No.
That in point of fact it hasn't worked, or to the extent that it does work, it would have worked even without such a systematic effort?
I don't think it's chicanery. What it is that having built in a structure in which they observe, they create by their method the very disaster which they're fighting.
Okay.
This is a commonplace.
Okay.
In
what about
society? Isn't it? I'm sure think of 100 other places where that's true too.
I want to hear you say it.
Yes.
let's lead on from this axiom of
yeah.
yours, that it is not worthwhile.
No, that's not an axiom.
That's
a hypothesis.
Well, I'd volunteer it as a hypothesis. I'm usually more reverential towards
yes.
what you write and treat as axiomatic. let's pursue then your hypothesis
yes.
and ask you this: a state ought not therefore to mobilize a public school system whose intention it is to force people to learn how to read, even those who approach the job reluctantly?
Well, that takes us into a broader issue. See, it's the chief function. I'm a Jeffersonian, and Jefferson felt, with Aristotle, by the way, that the chief function of a political society is to educate its young. That's what it's about. And we ought to be spending much more money on it than we do.
To make them liberate.
That's right. And as you remember, Jefferson felt that a very important part of that was that they should learn history, because by studying history, they could learn how to be vigilant for freedom. That's what he thought when cut out of history. And that would, of course, require literacy. But that would, of course, also require reading as an art. That is where you're reading not to know a code, but for truth and imagination and so forth.
But in order to read that way, you've got to learn how to read for instrumental purposes.
That's where I think you're wrong, if you think that. That's exactly what's wrong with our teaching reading.
Hypothetically or axiomatically?
That's what's wrong with our teaching at present. Mm-hmm. We take reading, instead of being an art, as if we're the learning of a tool subject. If we take a person who really knows how to teach reading, Sylvia Ashton Warner, you know, in New Zealand, her attitude is that reading is one way of helping a child to express to the other one, who's in the other room, for instance, by writing it down, what the child really wants to say, not Dick and Jane, but what the child really wants to say. So what she tries to do is...
But with reference to a vocabulary or without reference to vocabulary? Is it all onomatopoetic?
With reference to the child's actual speech at age 5. She teaches Maori.
Yeah, but then he just grunts.
No. They can speak. Mm-hmm. It's a question now of their reading and writing. They come in at age 5 or 6, And she tries to find out what is it that's on the child's mind today. Now, the words that are on little Mayori's mind, in the little Mayori's mind that day, she finds are always words of fear, that his papa's drunk again, the cop beat him up, or sex, or hunger. And therefore, the primary vocabulary of the child, chosen by the child, as it comes in full of a need to say something which is in his heart, for the first 2 years will be a most strange one. Mm-hmm. You know, it will consist of all kinds of sexual words and words like skeleton and, you know, wild lion and wild cat and words of hunger, you know, fruit and nuts. Mm-hmm. And if you compare her elementary vocabulary with Dick and Jane, you realize that in the one case, the art of reading and writing is the art which can lead to poetry and science. And in the other case, the art of reading and writing is the art which leads to suburban conformism.
Yes, but doesn't this always assume that Dick and Jane take over in the one case, where they don't in the other?
They do.
Whereas if Dick and Jane is simply viewed as a means by which one begins the alphabetization
of the
process.
But that's the error, though, you see, the separation of the means from the end. Mm-hmm. Because this is not, in fact, how we learn. Now I have a little three-year-old at present. And to her, words like brontosaurus or, you know, a tyrannosaurus rex are just the same as cat. It simply isn't the case that children learn monosyllabic words quicker than they learn polysyllabic words. Mm-hmm. She goes to the Museum of Natural History and sees this thing, and that one is called Tyrannosaurus Rex, and she knows that word. Tyrannosaurus Rex is ferocious, she says. But he's extinct, she says.
Yeah. Well, why would a public school system...
I mean, why not?
Why would a public school system exclude... what you just had to say. After all, what you're really talking
because
about is different pedagogical methods.
They have a wrong theory. Mm. And that's the trouble. See, the theory is not an accident that they have a wrong theory. They have the theory of social engineers. They don't have the theory of human teachers or artists. The theory of a social engineer always says that you can analyze everything down into its least elements, and you first learn 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you add them up to 2, 4, 6, 8. But this isn't at all how a person learns, because the person learns by an intrinsic need or reaching out. And what you reach out to is what's interesting. And if the text isn't interesting, then why bother? For instance, if I teach elementary Latin, and I have done this, I have unfortunately in my career had to teach elementary Latin, I at once wrote them a little manual which was pornographic. Because every kid of 11 wants to read that.
Well, aren't you simply suggesting a revision of teaching procedures? But why do you go on to make the inference that the entire public school system ought to be abolished?
Because if we have a system which is run centrally, where we have a million children, let's say in New York City, 50,000 teachers and a million children, it will always be run as social engineering.
Well, there's plenty of pornography in New York City.
Not in the school system, unfortunately. I wish there were more.
Is the problem therefore a quantitative one? I.e., you feel you are defeated because the problem is 1 million students, but you would not feel defeated if it was just your 3-year-old child.
I would feel better. I wouldn't feel altogether happy, but I would certainly feel better if the system were radically decentralized to little storefront schools, let's say, where you had 30 children and 3 teachers. And that wouldn't cost any more, by the way, because 2 of the teachers could be college students. You know, we give a couple of $1,000 a year, and 1 a licensed teacher. Where there's more human contact. I think we have to have the elementary school system in some form or another, because you have to relieve the home. That is, you have to have babysitting. And you also have to rescue the kids from their parents. Therefore, in some form or other, you're going to have elementary education. My objection to it is the curriculum. because every child is full of curiosity, is reaching out, wants to know something, and all a teacher has to do is to look at the child's eyes and try to guess what he's after, and he will learn enough.
Any parent can have difficulty trying to find what his child is after by looking at his eyes, but we'll try to find more about this in just a moment.
So you do acknowledge the desirability of taking students during some of the daylight hours and attempting to do something to them. Is this in a sense a capitulation to the idea of public schooling? Or are you saying only up until such and such an age, definitely not through secondary schooling, definitely not if they resist beyond a certain point? How do you handle this problem?
Well, I don't like the phrase, do something to them. I wouldn't mind do something with them. That's a human thing, is to do something with them. On the elementary level, I believe in the Summerhill system, as you must realize, which is a system where the kids have a say in what kind of institutions they belong to. They can fire the headmaster, for instance, very good thing. Often very, very fine practice. I was a trustee of a Summerhill school where, in fact, that happened.
Were you the headmaster?
Oh, no, I was just a trustee. No, I wasn't the headmaster. The notion that you have to motivate small children to learn is simply ridiculous. They want to learn. If you get into the trap where you have to motivate them, then something is wrong. You put them in an institutional setup where they can't be themselves and come out from themselves. Now, if we get to the later age, now we're in a much more serious situation. Because in this country, there always has been some kind of compulsory elementary education, pretty much for the total population. But if we take the high school age now, most people now don't seem to realize that in 1900, only 6% graduated high school. And this last year, I think the figure was 75%. And yet the schools have maintained pretty much the same institutional pattern, and yet it must mean something entirely different, because those 6% were, for the most part, rather motivated. They wanted to learn something. That's why they went to school. They went to high school. There were many other things to do. You could go out and get a job, and you could go into most professions without all these diplomas. Well, my brother, for instance, is an architect. He never went to high school. You know, and he's a professor of architecture. And with most professions at that time, except for doctor, it wasn't necessary to have any of these diplomas. We have now set up a licensing system, which is perfectly ridiculous, and a hiring system, whereby for every damn job in the world, you have to have a high school diploma or a college diploma. It's entirely irrelevant to anything which is done on the job. And the result is that young people for 16 long years are kept doing lessons. Now, most people, and I would say 85% of youth, maybe 80%, Conan thinks 85%, don't really learn well by doing lessons. Not that they aren't smart enough, but that isn't the way they learn. They learn by doing something for real. There are other types, academic types, I happen to be one of them, who learn very well, bookishly. You know, and by doing lessons and having some authority figure lead you by the hand. But most people learn much better on the job. And this applies to high technology, and it applies to languages, and it applies to literature and so forth.
Well, what are the roots then of the superstition, I guess you'd want to call it, that requires students to stay in school until age 16, or in some cases 17. Is it a part of the ethic of egalitarianism?
Yes, for one thing. There are many roots in the background. One, of course, was the need to keep the young off the labor market, to keep them on ice. No. The child labor laws, for the most part, were pushed, partly for humanitarian reasons, but partly in order to keep the labor market, unoccupied by all these kids. Secondly, and especially for higher education, college education, as we began to be an affluent society, and this began to happen around 1920, after the First World War, it began to be the feeling that the children of the middle class ought to have the luxuries of life. And one of the luxuries of life was to go to college, because that's what the children of the upper class used to do. And therefore the middle class, I mean, sold itself on this notion of the great virtues of college education. In 1900, by the way, 0.25% went to college. This year it's nearly 40%.
What would you say about the general level of education in 1900 as compared to, say, 1965?
It would depend if we mean...
Well, obviously, I don't mean in atomic physics.
No, if we mean the 0.25%...
No, I said general.
If we mean the 0.25% at the top to compare with the 0.25% then, probably ours is as good or better. If we mean for the 40%, it's not education at all.
General level of intellectual ability.
In the country, probably the same.
That is sad. I would like to test your thesis.
Probably the
same. That in fact people will learn and search out their own means of learning. And I wonder whether you have any reason to suppose that in 1900 people in fact did so.
Well, let's say this. In 1900 the society operated. That's for sure. That is, all of the professions were filled. The arts were practiced, the professions were practiced, science expanded, business was run, books were read, railroads were, run. Society went on very nicely.
Well, what would you say?
See, the burden of the proof really is on the colleges, isn't it, to prove that they're necessary, isn't it? Because without them, life went on. Isn't that true?
Well, except it is presumably manifest, yes, that they are necessary, i.e. there are willing sellers and willing buyers. But would you say that that the level of literature in 1900 was as high or higher, and the capacity to profit from literature, the addiction to the imagination, the interest in truth, was that as high then as it is now?
I would find it hard to make that decision. But I would say this. If we will look, let's say, at in Who's Who and so, at the biographies of writers, Dreiser, whatever you think of him, he was a very good writer, or editors, journalists, etc., from that time, it was extremely rare that you found one who had taken the steady course through all of the schools. They often quit high school, went to college for a year. Got into some college for a year, quit college, very rarely went through 4 years. The life course, which now is normal for every middle class kid, at that time simply did not exist for people who made their names in invention, sciences, arts, so forth. And all of the professions, as I say, except medicine. Mm-hmm.
Of course, there were fewer technical skills actually needed.
I don't believe that at all. I don't believe... Do you believe that?
Well, I assume that the machinery that was around was much less complicated. People can fix a wagon wheel without being able to fix an eight-cylinder engine.
I ran a seminar in Washington on for the government people on education, and I had some colonel in who was in charge of Army education, and I said, in the Army, they have very good schooling in the Army, by the way. How do you teach, say, radar repair and operation? He said, we can teach that to anybody in a year. On the basis of what prior schooling? None whatever. You mean he could be illiterate? Of course. Wouldn't make any difference whatever. He said, but in the Army we don't have any illiterates, because if they come in illiterate, in a few months we've taught them to read. My God, how do you do that? I mean, the public school systems are trying to learn that. He said, we use the or else method. Which isn't a bad method at age 18. I wouldn't use it at age 10.
Oh, I see. So your standards do change about the proper kind of exhortation at age 8 and age 18.
The standard's the same. Any person will do what's for real. Mm-hmm. And if he's put in a situation where to pass the examination is necessary,
he'll do it.
He'll do it. That doesn't mean he's learned anything. It means he's passed. Uh-huh. See?
Well, I'm getting a signal over here. You want?
Yes, and I think the signal is, Mr. Buckley, that we must pause here for just a moment. We'll return to firing line.
Mr. Goodman, maybe it would be a good idea to address your critique and your analysis to a number of concrete issues that are knocking around the joint here.
Yep.
For instance, it has been proposed to raise the compulsory attendance age from 16 to 18. You're against it, right?
Yes.
It has been proposed to forbid any state or federal monies from going into private church-related schools. You're against that, right?
Yes, I'm against that. Yeah. Oh, yes.
Now, would you be in favor, for instance, of some of the steps that were suggested for, let's say, ignoble reasons in the South during the past few years, steps by which, in fact, they could avoid racial integration, the business of handing over to each parent X number of dollars, which he could then proceed to spend at whatever school he saw fit to spend it?
I thought that was a marvelous idea for the wrong reason, mm-hmm. except I didn't see that they were handing the money over to the little Negro children, which would have been a great thing. I think one of the most valuable forms of education we could have would be to extend the GI Bill idea down to the high school level, since a kid wants to...
Why not pre-high school?
What? what would a 9-year-old do with $850?
Well, presumably she'd consult her parents on it.
Oh, well, then you mean give it to the parents?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, that's I'm for that. Mm-hmm. That's done in Denmark, by the way. If 20 parents have some educational idea and get themselves a licensed teacher.
Licensed?
Yes, a state licensed teacher.
You?
Oh, no. No, state licensed teacher. It would depend on what the rules of licensing are. Mm-hmm. There is such a profession. I'm not objecting to the fact that there is a profession of education. Mm-hmm. I object to our form of licensing. That is, there has to be some control over to whom you give 20 children. then those 20 parents can set up a little school and the state will pay for it. And in fact, 10% of the Danish elementary education is run in such free schools, meaning by free not that the all the schools are paid for by the state, but that the parents run the school the way they feel like running the school.
Well,
why not?
Does the state then supervise the standards with reference to any objective criteria?
No, except that if you want to go on the academic line, then in order to get into the next level, they make their rules as to what they'll admit on, like college boys. Mm-hmm.
But it's completely up to the parents whether or not they want to pursue an academic career.
That's right.
Of a kind that makes it possible for them to
That's
go into
or,
the
or,
higher
or if the parents are wise, it's up to the child. Mm-hmm. No.
Tell me this, Mr. Goodman, do you have any influence in the United States other than among people who admire your ingenuity and the originality of your insights? For instance, would you be invited to give a speech before the NEA, and would you survive?
Sure. Oh, I've done that. I've done that. I mean, I'm a court jester for the American people. You must know that. That is, they have to have someone who tells them the wisdom of the East while they go on in their folly, because it's good for their soul. And they've always, powers that be have always had such people. Mm-hmm. And there are a few of us at present.
And they indulge
that all
you.
The time. They indulge me. I guess I'm asked to talk on such bigwig occasions twice a week.
Mm-hmm.
And I unfortunately do it about once a month.
Well, do you feel that you're making any headway?
Or do you think that we're so locked into a rather mechanistic view of education as to make it highly unlikely that we will retreat in the direction of education?
I'd put it this way. I have, I'm a very important person for the radical youth. And I am not because I influence them or teach them anything. They're quite unteachable, thank God. But that what I do prove, at least to them, is that there are alternatives to doing what we do. And since they're totally dissatisfied with what we do, they can quote me as saying, well, Goodman says, we needn't do it that way, we could do it this way. Therefore, I perform a very valuable psychological service for them.
But you know what?
I don't know whether you'd call that influence.
Yeah, I've sometimes wondered whether you haven't been used by youth.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
That after all, here you are, in a sense, above it all, an anarchist, a genteel, intellectual aristocrat, that you absolutely require your mobility in order to preserve your own integrity. And yet, in fact, they sort of tread you into a movement.
No.
And when they start ruining the joint in Berkeley or lying on the tracks of the train headed for South Vietnam, up goes a Goodman banner. Actually, wouldn't it be a little bit more consistent to shrink from the utility of your name and reputation for that kind of purpose?
First place, as Omar Khayyam said, you know, I often wonder what the vintners buy when half so precious is the stuff they sell. The affection of the young is a great reward, me anyway. And therefore, I can hardly say they exploit me. They do work me to death. My last job was out at San Francisco State College, where I was hired by the students, you know, to be their teacher. That's a great thing, that this college paid out of student dues for its own teacher. And the point of it was that I was supposed to be teaching them what they weren't getting in the other school, but in fact I wasn't teaching any such thing. I taught the same thing, but they felt at least they could control me. Mm-hmm. And I suppose they could.
In what sense did they control you?
Well, they could control me. That is,
They were paying
my salary. They could fire me, and I was beholden to try to.
Did you insist on a contract?
We had a contract. Of course, we had a contract. Sure, it was all done in proper order.
Do you find them actually interested in a basic critique? Is really what I'm anxious to hear you express yourself on, or, as I say, are you simply an amiable eccentric? Who says heretical things, which they get sort of a charge out of listening to.
No. They're very serious. Mm. But you mustn't expect too much of them. See, we live in a society and where these kids have been subjected to a bad educational system at the college age for 14, 15, 16 years, in which they have never had a chance to find their own identity, certainly not their vocation. So far as they can see, most of the vocations in our society are corrupt. Very few are exempt from that. You know, the law is corrupt, business is corrupt, politics is corrupt, the physical sciences have become corrupt. Religion is becoming a little less corrupt for them, you know, theology, the seminaries and so.
God is beginning to shape himself out of their image.
That's right. Well, no, it isn't that. It's that
you might be hired in San Francisco.
No, it's that I think the existentialist Protestants and the Catholics too are beginning to realize that the conditions of modern times are dehumanizing, and they suddenly recall the fact that Christianity has got something to do with mankind, and since the secular society has no relation to mankind, they have to come to life. And therefore, it's a very rare campus in the United States that the center of radical activity is not in the chaplain. You know that. The young chaplain.
Yes, I know that. I know that there are alternative reasons for that.
Well.
Explanations for it, rather.
Yes.
There are those who believe that a lot of chaplains are attracted to that kind of activity because they themselves find their own religion deficient, or because they're alarmed at the alleged lack of contact with quote, reality.
Yes.
So I think that there are a number of reasons for that. But these youth, to what extent, in the course of deciding that our society is insufficient and that the ideals of our society are insufficiently humane,
yes,
to what extent do they turn around and blame the educational system for it, or to what extent do they rather simply assume that the educational system is a natural expression of a society so organized?
Well, I think the latter, but that is true, isn't it?
Well, I don't know.
I was at Rutgers yesterday.
I don't think you made that clear.
I was at Rutgers yesterday.
Sometimes you seem to be talking about teaching method.
No, I was at Rutgers yesterday, and what the students wanted to know, they were freshmen, it was a freshman orientation program, and what they wanted to know was, now that we're here, what should we do?
Listen to you to begin
with. Yeah, and they said, didn't I think that the educational system, and they had had 3 days of Rutgers, they'd been there 3 days, but they had been there long enough to say it looks very much like the rest of the organized system, as they call it. That is, they were processed, and they were IBM cards, and they were had to take all kinds of subjects which they knew were not going to be of much importance to them, not at that moment, because they weren't choosing them, and it wasn't what they were after, etc., and they were being processed again. Now, our society is great for social engineering, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Processing, by and large. And I think they know this. They know it at the high school level.
Yes, but they also probably worked very hard to get into that particular institution, didn't they?
They did, that's right. That's because they have to do it in order to get a union card, because they don't know what else to do with themselves, because their schooling has not given them any identity or vocation, and to avoid the draft.
Mm-hmm. You are watching Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr., tonight's guest, Paul Goodman. We'll be back with a question period in just a moment. Mr. Goodman, you have warned Americans against what you call a progressive regimentation, which could become, in your words, a fascism of the center.
Yes.
Do you see the seeds of this fascism in what is referred to as the consensus society of Lyndon Johnson?
Fascism of the center, that is. What you have is an establishment which has no tradition to warrant there being an establishment. I don't like to answer that question now, because the consensus has fallen apart with such a crash in the past couple of months, to my delight, that why kick that dead horse? The consensus now seems to be whether he should abdicate before 1968 or not.
Mr. Buckley, Albert J. Nock has written that virtually everyone is trainable, but that very few people are genuinely educable. Do you accept this distinction? And if so, what inferences do you draw from it for public education?
Well, yes, I do. I do accept it in the context in which Nock wrote about it. He tended to distinguish very sharply between someone who sought learning for the sake of learning and others who sought learning simply because it was a means by which he could acquire other things which are not necessarily related to learning, but which may not be achievable without it. And Nock, of course, was a very harsh critic of a confusion of the two systems. And I do think it's true that the public schools and the colleges, to a considerable extent, continue that confusion, compound it, and have a vested interest in it.
May I make
Please
a comment
do.
On that? It's not merely continuing it, it's become the orthodoxy now. It's called operant conditioning, and the system of the teaching machines is precisely to train, or instruct, as they say, rather than to educate. Education demands some intrinsic motivation, whereas training requires just programming.
Yes, but you say that all young people really want to learn.
Yes, but they don't want to be programmed. That is, they reach out, and then you give them what they're reaching out to. It's quite different if you decide beforehand what they are supposed to reach to.
In this context, Mr. Goodman, you've covered a rather wide range
yes.
of education from early childhood right through the normal college years.
I wonder if we could get your opinions on Operation Head Start of the anti-poverty program.
Well, Operation Head Start can be many things, like any nursery school situation. It's obviously very desirable for kids who never get a warm meal to get a warm meal, and for kids who, when they ask a question, to get cracked across the face and told to shut up, to have some adult, however inane, smile at them and be kindly, and to read them stories and so forth. That's all very good. Operation Head Start, however, is founded on a, and this, what I'm going to say now is not really very important. It's founded on a psychological theory, Martin Deutsch, which happens to be false, that there is such a thing as intellectual faculties, etc. It's the old transfer of training nonsense. But it doesn't make any difference. What's good about Head Start is that kids who are living in flats which are overcrowded, too noisy, have no warm meals, etc., nobody who pats them on the head, are now put in a room which is relatively quiet and with toys to play with and so forth, therefore great.
Mr. Buckley, would you agree that the main value of Operation Head Start is merely to give a warm meal and perhaps a pat on the head and a little peace and quiet?
Well, I think provided one uses the word Maine with some precision, Ms. Goodman may be right. That is to say, Operation Head Start is not conceived as a system that is going to turn a lot of people who would otherwise be illiterate into qualified students for the advanced institute of higher studies. But on the other hand, I'm perhaps a little bit less skeptical than Mr. Goodman, or at least more optimistic than Mr. Goodman, in hoping that some of those, in the course of having a warm meal, will also discover there is a certain intellectual excitement in reading and in wanting to learn.
Hope so, too.
That may be accidental, but...
Accidental, yeah, I hope so. Yeah.
It's a rather expensive accident, if I may add that.
Oh, well, it's a very rich society. The amount of money we spend on the decent things like this compared to what we blow in Vietnam is ridiculous.
Well, we wouldn't have decent things like this if we didn't blow money in Vietnam.
That's true.
Let's get off that subject.
Mr. Goodman, you're noted for what appears to me to be a paradoxical remark that more formal schooling often entails less education.
Yes.
And you seem to have been taken at your word by some of your admirers at Berkeley. Would you care to clarify that remark for us?
Simply that if we mean by formal schooling the running of an obstacle course, which has been thought up a priori by some dean or board of education. See, I was on the board of education and on one of the local boards in New York City, and I know whereof I speak. Then this has very little to do with education in the sense of offering in the environment of what meets a need to know.
Now, Mr. Buckley, you, of course, are a hero of what is referred to as the New Right. And Mr. Goodman, you are a hero, or as you phrased it earlier this evening, the captive of the radical youth.
Yeah, not the New Left.
But you do seem to have a great deal in common, yeah, certainly on many of these things. Do you see from this somewhat curious situation the possibility that there might be the beginning of a realignment of political forces in this country?
Is that to me?
Yes.
Well, yes, this was obvious in Berkeley itself, where you found that that the Goldwater youth and the were in the free speech movement for the for perfectly good reason. That is, they were all tired of being pushed around by lying administrators.
Oh, I don't think that's a very tight deduction.
Well, I think that's why they were together on this issue.
I don't think that they were. They participate in the free speech movement for the same reason necessarily that led them to back Goldwater.
No, that's true, but I think that the backing of Goldwater is meant very many different things.
Mm-hmm.
That is, there was a kind of hardcore lunatic fringe. I think even you would grant that. who backs Goldwater, just as this is a hardcore lunatic fringe and sure. the...
Unfortunately, less radical. Numerous than the lunatic fringe that backed Johnson.
Yes. that, I don't think, is a lunatic fringe. I think that was the loony bin itself.
Away from the subject of education, Mr. Buckley, but on that same question, may I ask you to answer it? Do you see any beginning of realignment of political forces in this country?
Well, people have remarked on a certain congruity in some of the recent passions and attractions of the libertarian right and the anti-establishment left.
Yes.
And I think that there is, I think that there are reasons that appeal to both of them. One of them is a sense of impotence as a result of the force of the establishment. That is to say, a desire to recover sovereignty over one's own affairs.
No, not and a sense of impotence, but a refusal to be impotent.
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah, that's right. They shrink from that, from that,
yes.
From that fear of impotence,
yes.
And that under circumstances that's true. However, I think that it's unfortunate to use Berkeley as a corpus vile here, because in Berkeley things went berserk, in my judgment, and people who were sensible saw the necessity of a basic order.
May I say something about that?
As a requirement of any freedom.
About that. I've been to Berkeley this year a good deal. I think that any impartial observer out there would say that both the academic atmosphere and the community atmosphere in Berkeley this year are far better than they have been in the last 20 years.
Well,
therefore, it's really very unfair to say that the insurrectionary troubles were for the bad.
Well, it's impossible to crack your syllogism if you accept the assumption. I maintain that somebody like Professor William Peterson or Professor Lewis Fuhr are impartial observers, and they come to precisely the contrary conclusion.
Fuhr hasn't.
I try to be an impartial observer, gentlemen. I dislike interrupting as much as possible, but we have to pause here for just a moment.
Well, Mr. Goodman, I have only 40 seconds in which to thank you very much. We'll spend the next hour debriefing my son, who is in the audience and goes off to a non-permissive boarding school tomorrow. But I do thank you very much, and I'm extraordinarily interested by your insights, as I'm sure everybody else is. And although I don't go with you all the way, I know that's not a matter of great concern to you.
But I'm not sure I do either.
I've greatly enjoyed listening to you and have profited a lot from this and your books, and thank you again.
Well, I'm glad to have been on the program.
Thank you.